Blame Parrot calling from Blame Parrot and Blame Parrot That Ain't Black podcast.com, where we get down on topics and subjects and stuff like that concerning black people, black Americans, African Americans, whatever you want to call you, that are doing unusual, different, unique things in business and sports, jobs and everything like that, that aren't considered stereotypical of what black people are considered to do. Like I said so many times before, most black people in America, unfortunately, are just labeled as rappers, dancers, and rappers, dancers, something like that. And then stuff like that, basketball, you're not doing that. A lot of black people, or a lot of black people, or people in general aren't really considered. They don't want to have nothing to do with you and stuff like that. So I want to go ahead and change that stereotype, change that narrative, and find out that black people do a plethora of things, many things. And I've been doing my research and everything, and black folks are in all kinds of different jobs, businesses, arts, education, you name it, but we're not known for it. So I'm trying to change that narrative. And I got a guest speaker on today. His name is Lance Randall. He's going for the 2021 mayoral candidate. Jenny Durkin's leaving the office and everything. And they got some jobs open, and he stepped up, and he wants to be one of the candidates that want to fill those shoes. So how you doing, Lance?
I'm doing pretty good, brother. How you doing?
All right, man. I was doing it's really good. You got a great homeboy. You got some great team players and stuff like that, because I emailed you yesterday about this. This is on Sunday. This is Monday morning. And they got back with me within a few hours. And I know you're a really busy man and everything like that. And he got on. We chopped it up and talked. He said, yeah, you definitely want to get Lance on your show and everything like that, because it's a very serious position that you're taking and everything. And he told me about you, your background and stuff like that. I'm going to go ahead and shut up for a minute and go ahead and let you talk. You got a really impressive educational and business resume. So go ahead and tell me a little bit about yourself, man.
Well, I'm originally from Macon, Georgia, which is an hour south of Atlanta. It's in the middle of the state and the closest city to Atlanta. Born and raised there. Went to the public schools there and graduated. And went to Morgan State University, which is a historical black college in Baltimore, Maryland, where I received a football scholarship to play wide receiver. And while there, I majored in political science. And I also had the opportunity to work with some very important people that I'm pretty sure maybe you know, maybe you don't, but Kwayuse Mfume, who was a U.S. representative from that area. He worked at Morgan State University. He was the head of our radio station. Another classmate of mine, I'm pretty sure you know this young lady, she was the nemesis of President Trump. She was the representative for National Black Radio. Her name is April Ryan.
Wow.
Yeah, April Ryan was a classmate of mine. And also had a chance to work with the Mitchells, Clarence Mitchell, Perrin Mitchell. These were key black leaders in the Baltimore, Maryland area. And my professor was a gentleman by the name of Dr. Augustus Adair. He's passed since, but his claim to fame was he grew up in Tuskegee, Alabama, and had an opportunity to play with Booker T. Washington's grandkids, even though he never met Booker T. Washington. So it was an honor to go to Morgan State. And my father also went to Morgan State University, graduated with a degree in political science. He also played wide receiver on the football team as well.
Well, you got to double up on that education there. And also you got like 2 degrees, one in politics, another one in business. Am I wrong or am I right?
Well, I have a degree in political science. I'm a graduate of the University of Oklahoma Economic Development Institute, which is a school for economic development practitioners. And I graduated from the institution in 2000. It's a very prestigious school, and it's very difficult to get in because you have to be in the business for 5 years. And then you go to the institute for 3 years, and then you write a thesis. And then you go back and you do the things that you need to do to grow your communities and keep businesses strong and vibrant. So, like I said, I'm one of not many African-Americans get a chance to go to that school. I'm one of a few that have gone to that school and graduated, and I received an award called the Robert Castle Award, which is given to the top student in their graduating class, and is selected by the peers. So I'm very proud of that award that I received.
So how'd you make it up here?
Well, you know, I decided I want to try to take a look around the country to see what was out there. I wanted to get out of the South for a while and put out some fillers and resumes and what have you. And Seattle was the first one to reach out to me. to say they were very interested in me coming out. So they flew me out to Seattle.
Wow.
I had a 15-minute interview. I thought that I had blew the interview, but come to find out, they had pretty much decided they wanted me to come out to do economic development for the city of Seattle.
Man, that's really good.
Yeah, so in 2007, I came out, and my job was to recruit businesses from around the world to Seattle, and also to keep the businesses that are currently in Seattle in place, which means that if they have any problems, issues, or concerns that I can help them with, then it's my job to pull teams of people together, whether it's city employees or financial institutions, education institutions, whatever I could do to keep these businesses in place and growing and thriving, that was my responsibility.
Wow, so
I have
really
a pretty good.
Good
track record of things I've done as far as bringing businesses and keeping businesses in Seattle.
Wow, okay. Now, my podcast is targeted at Black people, African-Americans, stuff like that, who are doing different things, and your name came up and stuff, and now I'm trying to influence and encourage other Black people to venture out and do everything that are non-traditional roles and stereotypes of what Black folks do. And what made you want to get in politics? I'll be honest here, because when I think of politicians, and you think of the OFWG, the old fat white guy. Some old fat white guy sitting up there, hey, do this, do that, vote for me, give me your money. And you know, I just don't relate to that. You know, I'm very proud. I always voted and stuff like that. I've always voted regardless of anybody and stuff like that. I'm voting for the Black people who sat back up and gave me the chance and opportunity, who got whipped and beat and put down, criticized and all that kind of stuff back in the day. That's why I voted and stuff like that. I owe my obligation to them and stuff. But when you look into the political realm and everything like that, you're thinking about pretty much some white person. And I'm Black and stuff like that. You don't see too many of us in here. And back in the 90s, we got Norm Rice and everything like that. And that was a really big boost for Black people in Seattle, because we didn't think that pretty much, hey, we couldn't get them kind of jobs and stuff like that. And Norm really did his thing, and that was really great and everything. And we had some other people and stuff. But what made you want to sit back up and enter the political realm?
Well, I have a long legacy. My family is deeply rooted in civil rights and politics. My grandfather, who was an outstanding businessman back in the 50s and 60s, was also a civil rights leader.
Mm-hmm.
He spent a lot of time with some names you're probably familiar with, Dr. King. He was very close with Dr. King, Reverend Abernathy, Julian Bond, Andrew Young. There's a guy that many people don't talk about who's very instrumental, was a guy named Hosea Williams.
Mm-hmm.
So my grandfather was part of that group of men, which was the leaders of the civil rights movement. Of course, Georgia was a hotbed of civil rights. So my grandfather had a strong legacy in that. He was a civil rights leader in Middle Georgia and actually did the bus boycott there, and is one of the most prominent civil rights leaders in that area. But he was also elected as the first Black county commissioner from Bibb County, Georgia, back in the 80s. And I had opportunity to work on his campaign and learn from him about being a good public servant in that regard. In addition, my father, who was an attorney, he practiced law, and he had a Earl Warren scholarship where he represented people in civil rights cases in the Northeast part of the country, in New York, Delaware, Philadelphia, Connecticut, and what have you. Then he came back to Macon to continue to practice law. And then he ended up being the first Black state legislator to represent Bibb County, Georgia. He held that position for 24 years. And then he was appointed by Governor Roy Barnes to be the first Black chief magistrate and judge for Bibb County. So he has 44 years in public service.
Mm.
And again, I had an opportunity to work with him on his campaigns and also helped him as he was a legislator and a judge. So I was very pleased to be part of that. Now, when he got appointed to that position of judge, it was assumed that I would run for his position. But I had gotten divorced and gotten custody of my four kids, two girls and two boys. So I opted not to run for his seat, but encouraged my younger sister, Nikki Randall, to run. And the deal was, if I ran her campaign, that she would run for the seat. So I did run her campaign, and she got elected with 80% of the vote. So she was the first Black female elected to the Bibb County, Georgia, the Georgia House of Representatives representing Bibb County. So I have a long legacy in civil rights and politics. And just to give you even more background, when I was in college, I had a chance to work for a Black senator from Prince George's County by the name of Gloria Lalla. So I was on her staff as an intern, helping her with policy points, what have you. And then when I came back to Macon, Georgia, I worked for a mayor by the name of Lee Robinson. I was on his staff, and my supervisor was a brother by the name of Israel Small. He was the first Black chief administrative officer, but we called him deputy mayor here in Seattle. So I worked under him, and he really taught me the ins and outs of municipal government, how to work with city council people, and also working with different departments during the budget process and serving constituents. So after working for the mayor for a period of time, I then started working for a U.S. congressman by the name of Sanford Bishop, a brother from Columbus, Georgia, who was the first Black congressman to represent the 2nd District of Georgia, which is predominantly white and it's peanut country. So I'm his director of constituent services. And in that role, I managed 16 people, and we were responsible for receiving and responding to any letters or phone calls that came to the congressman. See, we didn't have smartphones and email back in the 90s.
So yeah.
But we had a great operation. I had different protocols in place. And you said earlier about the quick response back to you when you reached out to us. That was one of the things that I put in place to make sure that the congressman looked good. Some protocols, which means that if you got a phone call from someone, you call them back within 4 hours. If you got a letter that week, one had to go out that week. So we represented 566,000 constituents in the 2nd District of Georgia. Five municipalities were part of our district, and I had a staff of 16, and we had one of the best operations in the U.S. Congress at that time. So that gives you an idea of my background in politics.
Yeah, because you got a big catalog, bro. You bigger, think of the phone book of political and social services. I was really impressive and stuff like that. What you're telling me, because I mean, I did on a Sunday afternoon. I had sent out about 30 other emails and stuff like that. I wasn't expecting to get anything back on Sunday. Then I picked up a call, and I thought, I've been getting these booty calls from the insurance companies and, change your insurance and extend your warranty. And I thought it was that, and I was about to, hit delete or whatever like that. I picked it up like, oh man, you really? I'm like, damn, they got back really that quick, that fast? I'm like, y'all Johnny on the spot. That was really, really, really impressive. Like I said, I talked to your homeboy and he said, hey man, I want to get him on in. We can't get him on in tomorrow. I'm like, tomorrow? Wait a minute. I ain't know nothing about that. I gotta go check the schedule, check with my producers and everything like that. See if we got time and everything. Like, I want to get it in as soon as possible. Let's jump on this and stuff, talk to my boy and stuff. You're like, wow, you want to get in tomorrow? I said, yeah, let's get in tomorrow. And here we are today and stuff like that, less than what, 12, 14 hours later, talking with you. Now, when you sit back and want to get in politics, let's be honest with you, America, Seattle's pretty much where Black folks up here in minorities are pretty much minority in a minority, and running for office in predominantly white affluent place is pretty, let's get real, it's kind of scary and stuff like that. I mean, I know that norm run back in the day and stuff like that, but we're, like I said, again, we're only like 7 or 8% of Seattle, and we have a big Asian population, everything like that, Latino and Hispanic and everything like that, but we're still kind of smaller portion of America in Seattle and stuff. And what makes you think you're going to win? What are you going to bring to the game?
Well, what I bring to the game is a different mindset. You said earlier about it being scary to be in a city that's majority white trying to represent people. But all of my life, I've been in situations where there's been challenges. As I said, going into economic development, you don't find many African Americans in that field.
Yeah.
So I would find myself many times when I first started in the profession, that I would go to different conferences and host different delegations, and I'm the only Black person there.
Yeah.
And what I had to do was take the teachings that I got from Morgan State University, where they said you will get the best education. Just as good an education you would get from Harvard or anywhere else. But we're going to teach you that you have to be courageous and you have to be the best, not just the darkest in the room, but the best in the room. So with that being said, I pride myself of carrying the torch that my grandfather and my father passed to me, where fighting civil rights, you're fighting against some very mean and vindictive white people in your era. But in spite of them shooting at his house and the Klan chasing him all the time, he always told me, you have to
stay courageous if you're trying to accomplish something on behalf of people. I've seen him do that. I've seen video footage of his work. I've read a lot of books about the things he's done and talked to him directly. My father the same way. And see, the difference is down south, people deliberately try to do things to disenfranchise Black people, as you can see with the change that they've made with the voting because of success.
Yeah, that's a big topic. Yeah.
Yeah, so those type of things I'm used to, but I also understand that we have the ability to face challenges. And the one thing that I know for sure when it comes to people, no matter what color you are, it's about economics. Everybody wants to be in a good financial situation. And if you can make that happen, no matter who they are, then you can achieve things. And I've been able to do that over my career. When I was first made a project manager to recruit businesses from around the world, and people would come to Georgia to visit, they were not expecting to see a Black man greeting them at the airport saying, "I'm going to work with you to see if we can get your business to come to Seattle." I mean, Macon. But after a period of time, they saw I knew what I was doing and I was able to make things happen. So there were a lot of tests and trials that white people put me through, but I proved that the skin color had nothing to do with my intelligence and was able to accomplish a lot. And then I talked about receiving the award at the University of Oklahoma. It may have been six people out of about 100 people in the class. So the six people by themselves did not elect me to get that award. But when you talk about Seattle is a different place. It's very diverse. It tends to be very in tune with the social justice issues that are going on around the country. And I think there's an opportunity here to begin to elevate more of the social justice things that we can get done here in Seattle. I think there's a clear understanding of wanting to see things happen, but what I'm bringing to the table is a Southern East Coast background of how you actually get things done and how you actually help Black people empower themselves so they can get things done to increase their wealth and influence when it comes to politics.
Okay, and what about, because when you get into politics and stuff like that, I hate to say it, but they got the same connotation as a used car salesman. Everybody's sitting up there running that same line. Hey, man, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that, I'm going to hook you up, I'm going to help you out. I'm the man, the other dude, forget him, come roll with me, you know. And then, like I said, I grew up here all my life and stuff like that. I'm born and raised South Seattle, went to Rainier Beach, live on Beacon Hill, live right now in the Central District, homeowner and everything like that. And everybody's trying to run this same old line, hey, I'm the best and stuff like that. Now, go ahead and tell me one more time, because you got a wealth of background in political and business and stuff like that. No doubt you're going to bring a lot of cards to the table. You got your cards on the table and everything. What can you sit back up and try to do that's going to be better than the next dude down the street or other girl around the block?
Well, I let my record speak for me. Let's talk specifically about Black folks and what I've done in the Black community.
Okay.
That people may not know about. So back when Obama got elected as president, they put together a program called New Markets Tax Credit Program. And that program was designed to allow investors from around the country to invest in low income census tracts. And they would get a return of 39% in tax credits that they would use against the federal tax liability. So the city of Seattle was able to get some tax credits available through this program. The very first New Markets Tax Credit Program where a developer from across the country invested into a project was for a Black company owned by Craig Dawson. I don't know if you know Craig, but he owns a company called Retail Lockbox. Mm-hmm. He wanted to purchase a building, but he was not getting the type of interest rates that he wanted in order to make it happen. So I reached out to Craig, we had a great conversation, and I suggested that we try the New Markets Tax Credits. So we put together a proposal and we got someone to invest. And as a result, Craig was the first company in the city of Seattle, Black owned company, to be able to buy a $7 million building with New Markets Tax Credits. And that building is located at the corner of 14th and Yesler. So not only does that building house Craig's business called Retail Lockbox, but that's the same building that houses the Urban League.
Wow, that's really big. The thing about that is I live in Seattle, like I said, in Central District. This is the first time I heard about that. And definitely you want to encourage black businesses and stuff like that, especially in South Seattle and everything. Because only thing, I grew up here, we primarily, when it comes to business, the only thing we pretty much own is churches and stuff. And I'm tired of that stuff. You know, I'm going to be straight up with it, you know, because we got a lot of business opportunity down there. And it's ridiculous because there's businesses down there, but black folks ain't earning them. But there's obviously money in the South Seattle because those businesses wouldn't be there if they didn't have customers. And right. Definitely you're a resident also of South Seattle and everything. And what can you do? I mean, when I sit back and I look for somebody for city council, I want somebody who looks like me and stuff like that. I want to sit back and try to, oh, you just sending out to the brothers. No, I just want somebody who's going to be walking in my shoes, got my same kind of experience and sees it coming from my background and everything. So can you go ahead and expand on that a little bit?
Yeah, well, you know, the one thing about being a black elected official, we have to look beyond the fact that now we have someone black in the position. Mm-hmm. And you have a time limit to be in that position, whether it's a U.S. congressman at 2 years or a mayor at 4 years.
Yeah, so the clock is ticking.
Mm-hmm. That time frame, you have to make things happen for people. And you have to make things happen. It's one thing to get in there and talk about it and be proud that I'm the first black or whatever elected, but mm-hmm. you're elected to get something done.
Yeah.
But I think in order to gauge if that person is the right one to be in that position, you have to look at what they've done before getting elected. Mm-hmm. And I need to tell you a little bit more about some things if you're surprised about that. I don't know if you're familiar with the Seattle Design Center down in Georgetown. It's two buildings. They house these designers here in Seattle, and they have relationships around the world where people come in and they design furniture and clothes and what have you. And then there's an office building. There are two buildings. They're a total of 505,000 square feet.
That's big.
And they're connected by a bridge. So if you ever get a chance to go down to Georgetown, down 4th Avenue, you see the Seattle Design Center. Several years ago, I helped two men of color purchase those buildings for $20 million.
Wow.
A lot of people don't realize two brothers of color that live between Seattle and Beverly Hills, and I helped them be able to get that building. And then they also made a donation of about $500,000 to the Georgetown Merchants Association as a community benefit to get air rights to that bridge. So let me go a little bit further. Let's talk about our community. I live in Rainier Beach. Mm-hmm. Are you familiar with the Planet Fitness?
Yeah.
That's right across from Rainier Beach High School.
Yeah. Definitely.
I'm responsible for bringing that gym to that location.
Impressive.
It is the largest Planet Fitness in the state of Washington, and it's owned by a brother who lives in Baltimore.
Okay, you're telling me about this stuff, but I'm black and from South Seattle, and I'm not hearing this stuff. Why is it that? Because I want brothers, like I said, I graduated from Rainier Beach, man. I used to be Big Bear back in the day. I grew up in Rainier Beach, literally, man. I know that entire area and everything like that, South Beacon Hill and everything, you know. My ghetto pass is good, you know. I'm not hearing this, and I want other black people around my neighborhood, my same age range and younger and stuff like that, to know about this stuff and what's going on so we can look up to and aspire to owning something like that. Because you got $20 million thing down in Georgetown, the Planet Fitness, the $7 million thing going in the Central District. I'm not hearing about that, and I'm pretty sure that other black people aren't hearing about that. What do you have to do? I mean, what can we get out there to find, hey, black folks is doing this stuff. I want to get my foot in the game too, you know. I just don't want to be sitting up here just to be a worker, because we get grown up, go to school, get you a good job, go work for the man, and that's about it. You know, and I'm like, no, we can do more than that. And I'm trying to inspire black people and African-Americans and stuff, men and women like that, to be a part of that. Why am I not hearing this? This is ridiculous.
Well, this may be unusual up here in Seattle, but this is something that happens all the time in the Southeast. You've been to Atlanta, correct?
Yeah.
And there's many, many affluent brothers and sisters down there.
Yeah.
This happens all the time.
It's like night and day. I mean, I didn't know black folks living like that. I came, you know, I'm like, oh, man, it's ridiculous. Yeah. I'm about to run out to SeaTac, buy me a ticket and fly on down there. I said, come on, man, there's no opportunity up here. One of the biggest things, I started trying to get in radio and stuff like that. And they said, well, Blaine, why don't you get in radio And it's ridiculous because I lived all my life and we never had a full-time African-American disc jockey.
Right.
Playing our music and stuff. And they're playing our music, and I had a hard time being a black person getting a job that's primarily in the station owned by white folks, and they're playing our music. And it's ridiculous. It's come on, man. You a brother. They playing the music, and I got a hard time, and the other black folks too got a hard time. And I look, like I said, I've been here my damn life. We never had a full-time black DJ. So I'm like, no, I'm about to bounce out of here. You know, I'll be better somewhere else where they do have, they recognize black folks and stuff. And that's why they began radio and stuff. I never took it really seriously. Now, what you can sit back, you got all this education, you got these connections and everything like that. What can you do to be hooking the brothers and sisters up in our community and everything?
Well, anytime the brothers and sisters, they contact me all the time. Whenever they ask me to do something for them, I get it done.
Okay, now, go ahead, man. Go ahead. I don't want to cut you off there.
And that is the key. What I'm seeing here is that we have to get closer. We have to get a better relationship with one another, and we have to begin to think bigger.
Uh-huh.
And once we do that, we have the skills, we have the ability, the financing is here. But what we have to do is we have to elevate our game and say, hey, you know, we can do this.
Mm-hmm.
We can do this, and we have to come together with strategies, and we have to be persistent in pursuing things.
Uh-huh.
And be honest, brother, we got to be nicer to one another.
Yeah, there's no doubt about that. There's no doubt about it. Black folks up here are kind of funny, because I heard that from other blacks who come visit here or come stay here for a minute and say, y'all black folks up here are funny buckets. Y'all funny with each other and stuff. A lot of them don't even feel comfortable and stuff. I know black folks even left and stuff. And there's one brother, he was doing some stuff with the NAACP and stuff, and he was here for a quick minute. And he said, dang, y'all don't get along. He said, I got to bounce. He said, this ain't working out, man. I'm just being straight up honest. He said, I got to bounce and stuff. And like I said, I want to sit back up here. And I got an old saying, you can't beat what you can't see and stuff. Like one of the things that inspired me to do this podcast, because they had this one brother back back when I was in high school and stuff like that. He owned a biological company. And he does the test samples and stuff like that for the hospital. And I thought, oh, this brother went to school, got him a good job, and he's working there. I was real proud of him. He said, no, brother, I own the company. That kind of really blew my mind. I said, you black, you own the company. This is like back in 1988. He had $2 million contract, and I had a $2 million contract. I ain't no brothers can make that kind of money and stuff. I was just thinking, hey, you go to school, you black, go to school, you work for the man, get you a good job, shut your butt on up, go about 30 years and retire. I never thought about somebody black owning a company and stuff. That just really blew my mind. That's why I want to try to start my own podcast to inspire other black people and other black men, and especially younger ones and stuff like that. We got all this technology and everything like that to strive for beyond the stereotypical roles and ideals that most people have us believe that we are limited to. So go ahead, because you live in South Seattle, and I like a person who's going to be running in the city. That's why I like Bruce Harrell and everything like that, because they actually live in the hood. Let's be honest. You live in the hood. I don't want to get nobody living out in Macon County. Out in Orton, Washington.
I'm right in Rainier Beach.
Yeah,
right,
exactly. Because
and I've been all over helping, companies all over Rainier Beach. There's a young lady who has a nonprofit called Dignity for Divas.
Uh-huh.
She helps women who have gone through abuse. I was able to help her find her first spot, and now she has been given a building by Microsoft to expand her operation. But we got to start it.
Yeah, that's what I'm talking about.
So me and this young brother named Anthony Austin, who is the head of Southeast Youth and Family Services, and I'm the president of the board. It's an organization that provides mental health services for youth of color in Southeast Seattle. We were able to help him get into our building. And we hired Anthony some years ago, and I've been mentoring him. He's doing a great job. You're talking about a radio station. I actually was responsible for doing the construction of a low-power radio station in Southeast Seattle called KVRU 105.7. So, because my grandfather was a contractor, so I was able to do the construction. So there is a low power station in Southeast Seattle for KBRU. I just built it. I don't run it or operate it. I just kept within the budget to actually build the station.
That's good, good, good.
And I also have my own company. I have an audio sound reinforcement company called the Affordable Sound Company.
Man, I do. You're doing so much, man. Are you sure you got time to be a mayor?
Yes, I do. And also, I'm a musician. I'm the head organist up at First AME Church.
All right, good, good. Now, we got a lot of problems in South Seattle and stuff like that. Yeah. Now, I'm not going to, try to sugarcoat nothing and stuff. 2020 was a year of years. I mean, we had a COVID stuff. People got laid off. Businesses got shut down. They're trying to reopen again. They got a lot of issues and problems going back and forth with the COVID kind of stuff. And, luckily businesses are trying to rebound and stuff like that. And you have your business degree and everything like that. I definitely know you can help them out big time and everything. But also we got a lot of problems and stuff. It was a lot of racial tension and stuff. We had the January 6th kind of, I call it the takeover or the siege or whatever, like from the Capitol building. With Donald Trump and all that kind of stuff. And also we got the police getting laid off and stuff. Not laid off, they're taking off. They're like, we out of here, we gone. We ain't getting supported, we ain't getting no money, we ain't getting no paychecks, we bouncing. Being a black person and stuff like that, we'll go ahead and try to address that the January 6th thing. And that happened and everything, and that was really bad. Now, January 7th, a lot of black folks, including you and probably thousands of millions of other black folks, woke up on January 7th, and they all came to agreement that, hey, if that would have been us, it would have been a whole lot more different.
Right.
You want to try to give your feelings on that, and what's that about?
Well, what we're seeing is nothing new, man. This has happened many, many years, where you have people with racial biases that get on the police force and they hide behind their badge to do certain things to us in the streets because they know that they can. And if we retaliate, we have issues because they're police officers. So it's nothing new for people to get to infiltrate the police departments to continue to do that dirty work against black people. It's nothing new. It's nothing new for people to have done what those six officers done. I mean, it happens. And it will continue to happen. Institutions have a tendency to be infiltrated by bad people. And what do you do as black people? What we do, we go in and take over the institutions. Mm-hmm. That's one thing that we have to start doing more of up here in Seattle, is taking over institutions. That is one thing that we were taught at Morgan State, and they'll teach you at any HBCU. When you look at the institution of the Supreme Court, it took a while, but our brother Thurgood Marshall stuck with it till he finally infiltrated the institution by becoming the first black justice. Mm-hmm. And then once he did that, he made certain landmark decisions and led the way in that regard. You talked about Norm Rice. He infiltrated an institution here in Seattle, becoming the first black mayor. And that happens all over the country. Uh-huh. So what has to happen when it comes to our police department, which is an institution? Yes, protests. We bring to light the atrocities and things that are going on, but more so, now we start making moves to take over the institution. This is what happened down in Atlanta. I don't know if you know this, but you have Atlanta, which is Fulton County, you have DeKalb, Cobb, Gwinnett, Clayton, the other counties that surround it. After the insurrection and all these things that happened in the elections 2020, all of those counties decided that they would run and elect black sheriffs. Mm-hmm. So all the largest counties around Atlanta have black sheriffs. This is where black people said, if white people are not going to do right by us with these institutions, we'll go in and take them over ourselves. And that's what they did. That is the mindset we have to have. When it comes to banking, there are certain rules and regulations that everyone has to follow. But if someone is within that institution and will try to practice systemic racism and try to do things the way they want to do. No, what we have to do is get people to step in to be presidents and loan officers in those organizations. Yeah. That is what I'm saying. We have to think bigger and go after bigger things and say, we will control it ourselves since we're not getting the right people to go in. And that needs to happen with the police department, the mayor's office, city council, what have you. And brother, I said this, there are two councilmen, there's two candidates in this race that I had to say something to them. Mm-hmm. I do understand that there is an issue, and it's always been an issue, about rogue police officers, biased officers, killing black men and women. Nothing new. It happens. Mm-hmm. But what we have to continue to do is get them off the force, hold them accountable, lock them up for good, and then keep those type of officers off the force. But here's what bothers me, mm-hmm. is that I'm hearing people give the impression by certain statements that Black people do not want police protection in our communities.
No, that's definitely wrong.
But two colleagues that are running are saying that we need to take money from the police department, and give it to nonprofits in our communities. And that's supposed to be alternative to keeping us safe. And I got on that case in a forum. I said, I'm sick of you talking about that. You are speaking as though we don't want police officers. We do need protection just like everybody else. We just want the right officers to come.
Exactly.
So stop saying to take the money from the police department, put it in nonprofits in our communities. What's the trade-off if that happens? No protection for us. So I said, that's not what we want. Let's get these bad officers off the force and make sure we got as much protection in our community as everybody else with the right officers. So stop saying that. That is not what we want. And I think we speak up more about those issues and basically say what we want, what we need, and then we make demands that this needs to happen. And then we move more into leadership positions. I found it quite strange that we have the previous council, we had no African-Americans on that council. And it should. We should never have a city council without at least one or two African-Americans on that council.
Because my feeling is,
step up by game.
Yeah, because my feeling is that if you're going to be the people, should the people who are governors should reflect the people that they're being governed. You know, I mean, if you have, that's just it. You just have Asian people, Latino people, Black people, white people, gay or whatever like that, whatever background, we're being governed. We're getting our taxes and stuff like that. And they should be a representative of the people that they govern and everything like that. And yeah, and that's just it. And we definitely need police officers and stuff like that. No one's arguing that we don't need police officers. You're trying to take somebody's paycheck is a dirty move on my part. We do need them because they're bad people out there. I did security around Seattle and stuff all my life and stuff. And they're bad people out there. And somebody needs to deal with them. That's just the bottom line. I'm sorry. You can get mad at me all you want and call me Uncle Tom or whatever. I don't give a damn. We do. There are bad people out there. We do need a police force to take care of those bad people. They just they need to take what they're doing and govern them and put out those laws and rules and regulations equally and fairly to everybody.
Right.
Go ahead.
Just to prove your point, brother, I don't know if you heard about this, but a couple of weeks ago, it hit national news. I heard someone trying to steal a catalytic converter.
Yeah.
Out of my neighbor's Prius. This is in my neighborhood. Now, these are two white guys, two white dudes.
Yeah.
In my neighborhood.
Yeah.
Trying to steal. I go out to try to get information, to identify and get information on the tag in the car. They see me and they decide to shoot at me.
Yeah.
And that in itself tells you, yes, we need police protection because we have other enemies.
And this is the middle of the daytime, too. Am I correct?
Yeah.
Broad daylight. I
mean, they literally tried to kill me, man. They shot at me. And it came through my foot.
If I could interject, I've had my catalytic converter stolen twice. And I live here in Seattle. That is a major problem.
Yeah.
That's got to be talked about. It's getting real popular. In the one of them was in the daytime.
Yeah.
So thank you for bringing that up, Blaine.
Yeah. And I live, like I said, in the Central District, right off of Martin Luther King Jr. Way in the Central District. And down the street at the Starbucks, I get my coffee from, I call it the Junction or whatever like that, the South Seattle Junction, where you get the Rainier and meet Martin Luther King Way. And they got Franklin High School there. Middle of the daytime, they was busting caps at 1 o'clock in the afternoon, middle of the daytime. Anybody lives in South Seattle knows Rainier Avenue is the biggest, busiest street. And this is the middle of the dang day. And these fools, bright sunlight, thousands of people going up and down, and they're shooting. Every time you turn around, these fools is off the damn chain. This is ridiculous. And don't get me wrong and stuff like that. I believe in Second Amendment rights and everything like that. But these fools are just off the damn chain. They're like down in Rainier Beach where I grew up, went to high school and everything like that. They be busting caps left and right. And I don't know what's going on and stuff like that. And cause this is ridiculous. I mean, it's embarrassing. It's embarrassing and stuff like that.
Well, I'll tell you what's going on, man. You know, like I said, I've been in Baltimore. I've been in New York, Atlanta. Mm-hmm. you see the unprecedented level of graffiti that's all around the city, right?
Yeah, yeah.
That is a sign that there are some gangs that have come to Seattle.
Mm-hmm.
And they have a gang war going on, and we're caught in the middle of it.
Yeah.
That's and the reason why is because our dirty laundry was aired across the country, which said that we have cut the funding for our police department and officers are leaving. And they said, well, the city of Seattle is having an issue with public safety and their police officers. Let's go there and see what we can do. And that's why they're here. We've lost a lot of police officers because of what has happened. And I think that what we should have done was continue to focus on getting the bad officers off the force rather than taking a brush and painting it across the entire police department, which have caused some officers to leave, and some of them that look like us.
Mm-hmm.
Some officers that look like us, women officers, you know, we have to have police protection, but we have to make sure we have the right police officers. And I think that that's the main goal that we should have. And one of my strategies to try to do that is to start what we call the Youth Public Safety Academy.
Uh-huh.
To try to introduce our young people in their junior and senior years in high school to a career in public safety. And this is one way to sort of put money into our youth's pocket, but at the same time, exposing them to a potential career opportunity. And the way it works is in your junior year, during the summer, you sign up for the academy. You either can go down the path of wanting to be a police officer, a fireman, a paramedic, or a human service provider. So let's just say there's a young brother that decides he wants to take a look at being a police officer. So we pay that young dude a nice amount of money for internship program for the summer. We give him official uniform, but no guns or weapons. They take a couple classes in civics, gun safety, and community policing. And then the rest of the summer, if they just imagine they're here in Rainier Beach, whatever officers are patrolling Rainier Beach, you're riding with that officer every day for the rest of the summer, learning what it's going to take to be a police officer. And then I imagine this scenario. Say this guy's riding around with this officer. They roll up on a basketball court where he sees some of his buddies playing ball. Right, naturally, when they see the police car pull up, they're going to get apprehensive. Mm. When they see the young brother get out on the other side and they see him with a uniform on, the tensions now be turning from tense to curious. Like, what are you doing? He says, well, I'm thinking about looking at this as a career. So I'm part of this program. I'm getting paid through this internship program to learn what it can potentially take to be a police officer. Now, that officer, which is there with him, this is maybe the first interaction, or maybe not, but this is a different interaction with the police officer than the usual interaction, because you got a young brother there with a uniform on. He's there with the officer. And now you have a more cordial conversation among the officer and these teens, this young brother who was looking at being an officer there in the midst. So what I'm trying to do is create a situation where we get more people of color into law enforcement so that they can come back and patrol our communities. And I know right now people don't look at it as a good profession because of what's happening. But as I said before, when institutions going bad, Black people have a legacy of going into institutions and turning them around for the good of all people. And this can happen here. The more people of color, the more of our youngsters in our communities that will get into law enforcement. And as a matter of fact, some historically Black colleges are really pushing people to go into criminal justice. And they're trying to turn out as many top level, well-educated criminal justice majors to begin to go after top positions in police departments around the country. We want to flood the institution with qualified Black people to take over leadership positions so that we can have the diversity we need and the respect that we need in our communities when it comes to policing.
Yeah, I'm trying that was a big thing, because back in the day, like 20 years ago, I was kind of a rebel and stuff like that. So I'm glad that you live, like you and Bruce live in a community and stuff like that, because I remember I went to a council meeting and stuff, and wasn't nobody look like me and stuff like that. So they started talking and stuff, and I got on up and I just asked them. I said, well, go ahead, tell me what zip code y'all live from. And they kind of like, well, that's kind of stupid kind of thing. And then I said, well, zip code is, oh, I'm living in Orton, I live in whatever. And I turned around and look at everybody, what direction do you even know what Orton, Washington is even in?
And most of the people didn't even know. Mm-hmm. You sitting up here trying to represent me. You don't live in the hood. You don't know nothing about what it is and what it's about. You going to sit back and try to come on in and tell me how to live my life? That's disrespectful to me and stuff like that. You don't live here. You don't have any vested interests. You don't know what the people is about and everything like that. Why in the world would I want to sit back up and listen to somebody who never lived in my zip code? You don't got no street cred. I mean, do you really know what you're talking about? You just look like some, I call them paper pimps. You got this degree and everything. That's all good and everything. But that's about it. You like a paper tiger and stuff. Doesn't mean nothing to me. You know, right. You're making all these laws and rules and stuff like that. And it's ridiculous. And like I said, it's an OFWG, the old fat white guy in the office and stuff like that. And I said, this guy doesn't relate to me. This guy is like 8 to 4. He's going to punch his clock in, jump in his car, jump on A5, and go north, south, whatever like that. The hell away from here. He ain't got no interest in here. You know, he ain't going to deal with me till Monday morning and stuff. If something went off tomorrow night, he ain't going to deal with it. He's going to, I'll talk to you tomorrow morning at 9 o'clock and stuff like that. Because they don't have any interest in any kind of in the community at all. And it's embarrassing and stuff. Now, also, we have a lot of issues with crime and stuff like that. Can you go ahead and expound on that and what kind of steps or anything that you're going to take to try to reduce it beyond with the police or anything like that, any community projects?
Yeah, well, the first thing, when I talked to you about the gangs that have come here, they're here.
Uh-huh.
They're not based in Seattle, but they're here and they're trying to recruit.
Uh-huh.
And this is typical around the country in certain major cities like Seattle.
Uh-huh.
And this is the advantage of having a black mayor, because like you're saying, they don't trust and they're not going to talk to white mayors.
Uh-huh.
Most black mayors are able to identify who the leaders are and get them to a private meeting to get them to do a truce, because it's a sign of respect for them. And that I'm not trying to lock you up. I do understand what's going on, but I want you to understand that too many people are getting killed because of this war.
Mm-hmm.
And many black mayors across the country have done this, where they find who the leaders are, they bring them together in the meeting, and they get able to get a truce. And then we try to figure out how to keep the community safe while they're trying to work out their differences. And ultimately the shooting stops. And then they begin to work more into the communities on different things. And even though it's separate communities, and eventually they go back from where they come from, because they realize that they don't want to make, I'm just being real, they don't want to make the brother look bad if he's the leader of the city.
Exactly.
So that's number one. Number two, I talked about introducing our youth to job opportunities. And when I'm talking about job opportunities, there's nothing wrong with working at McDonald's and places like that. That's just to make money.
But
we need to uh-huh. make sure we get our youth into positions where they see a future down the road where they can really elevate themselves.
Uh-huh.
And that's why one of the things I'm going to launch is the most comprehensive internship program for students in high school all the way through college, where they will be working in city departments, learning how to do different jobs, and it'll be paid internships.
Uh-huh.
That they will have working in the mayor's office, working in the police department, OED, City Light, SDOT. I want every department to have a pot of money in their budget designed for paid internships for our youth, so that when the summertime comes and it's hot, that they have something to do that's productive and they're getting paid to do it. That is one way that we cultivate the minds and get them focused on career paths rather than just spending time, because you know, with an idle mind, things can happen.
Exactly.
And these are the things that I've been part of, me and my colleagues, where we had opportunities for these internships, paid internships. Now, even if you have different activities that need to be done, I was talking to someone yesterday, they were saying that the recreational programs are not where they need to be. I remember our recreational programs were outstanding, whether it was football or basketball, and a lot of the coaches, a lot of the mentors that I knew of were police officers. They coached us. So we had relationships directly with police officers through sports. We had direct relationship with the business community through internship programs. And a lot of times these companies invested in our future, making sure we had money when we went off to college. And then when we came back for Christmas and holidays, we had a decent job to work and made good money. So what I'm getting at is we're going to have to be more proactive and more strategic to make sure that we put things in front of our young people where they can see a future that is bright, where they don't have to worry about a lot of things. Right now,
if they're looking at TV and social media all the time, they're not seeing a lot of positive things. So it's up to us to show them a true reality that can happen by getting them more active in these type of internship programs and more recreation programs where they're interacting with key people. And right now, we don't have enough of that right now. So if anything, they're talking about taking money from we need to make more investments when we talk about investment in community of color to make sure that we're creating a pathway for our youth to keep them protected. And also, and we'll touch on this, creating opportunities for Black people to create wealth on their own in their own neighborhoods.
Exactly.
I am tired of developers coming in, putting together several parcels of land to build these huge developments. These properties are owned by people of color, and we have to create a situation where they can be their own developers and create wealth for themselves. And we have not done that. We have not pushed the private banks to come up with special private programs that people can participate in so they can get the money that they need to redevelop their business, to purchase a commercial space, to renovate their homes, to redevelop. And we haven't put a program in place within the Department of Housing where Black people can partner with nonprofits to build affordable housing. It may not have to be a major unit, but it could be 20 units. It could be 10 units of affordable housing.
Exactly.
Why isn't that Black people are not able to take part in all these different ideas? Now, you hear a lot of people talk about it, but when it comes down to really making a way for it to happen, you hear crickets.
Yeah.
So that's what I'm bringing to the table. See, you're going to have somebody in there that has the courage to stand up to them. And I've already told you, that's in my bloodline.
Exactly.
Another thing, too, is understanding what has to be done from a business and political perspective. And that's what I'm bringing to the table.
Yeah, because I remember I bought my place back in 97 and stuff like that. And I just wanted to get my own place and stuff. And I was one agency, and they let me put some money down and stuff like that until I get. It's a really great program and stuff. Now I own it and stuff like that. And back then, folks were laughing at me and stuff. Now I looked at the books. Now it's worth a lot of money. And I sure am glad I sit back and had that program and stuff. And I had this one Black guy, he's kind of mentoring him. He said, "Nah, you want to buy something, bro. You want to buy something. You definitely want to buy something. You know, don't be written out. You a damn fool to be written out." You know, I was young and stuff like that. I'm like 27 years old. He said, "Nah, man, jump on this program." And we definitely need people like that also in the community colleges to get brothers into the trade schools and stuff like that, being carpenters, electricians, plumbers and stuff. Because I remember I was like 18 and stuff like that. They just kind of like had this half-ass program. "Hey, you want to be a plumber?" I said, "Plumber? What's that? You know, you got to do 2 years this." And I'm like, "No, I don't want to do that, man. I'll go work at Safeway and make this money and stuff." Well, later on, I didn't find out. After you get those 2 years to trade school and all that kind of stuff, you'd be making this kind of money. And I was talking with some guys the other day. They're making 48, 50 bucks an hour and stuff like that, being master plumbers. I said, "Man, I was 20 years ago. I could have been rolling in dough and everything like that." And there's one guy, he's an electrician and stuff like that. And I didn't know. Come from South Seattle, growing up, graduating from Rainier Beach, there were a lot of people in the trades program, but there were no mentors, anyone to look up to, and any kind of things funneling into those schools to sit back and say, "Hey, man, you can do this, dog. You can be a, you can get into the contracting and stuff like that, construction and all that kind of stuff, and get good jobs and stuff like that." There are there opportunities and stuff there for you too, but I didn't have no one to look up to, and it was really kind of bad. Also, what can we do as far as when you get into the mayorship and everything like that? They still got a lot of issues and stuff with other things like gentrification and stuff like that. They're coming into South Seattle neighborhoods, buying everything. What's going on with that?
Well, one thing that has to happen, we have to stop these house flippers from coming in. What they do, they buy these houses and they flip them and sell them for a premium. We need to consider them as a business, not as investors. They are a business, which means that you're going to have to get a business license and register with the city of Seattle that you are a flipper of houses.
Uh-huh.
And your business license is going to be pretty difficult to get, which means that if you are out here trying to flip houses in our community, you're going to pay a heavy price to be able to do that. So we have to stop the flipping, and we have to create programs where people in our community can purchase the house. For example, in Congress, I think Congressman Maxine Waters is leading an effort to get legislation passed that will allow Black people to be able to get assistance with down payment, you know, $25,000 to $50,000 in order to buy a house. We need to work with our banks to put such a program together here in Seattle where we are willing to take a risk on certain people and help them be able to get the money that they need, the down payment that they need, and the loans that they need to purchase this property. And you have to put pressure on banks. The reason why is because we run a lot of money. The city of Seattle runs a lot of money through these banks. But these banks are still not doing right by Black people. But they're but some of the tax dollars that are coming through these banks that we generate, we're running through these banks. So this is where I'm taking a page out of Maynard Jackson's book, who was the first Black mayor of Atlanta, where he told these banks, if you're not going to do right by Black people and their tax dollars are being shuffled through your banks because you're one of our partners, I'm just going to stop doing business with you. We use other banks. He said, I use a bank in San Francisco. I use a bank in Birmingham. I'm not going to use local banks if you're not going to treat our people right. And I don't think there's ever happened here where a mayor is basically saying, listen, you run a lot of tax dollars through your banks and you're still having predatory lending practices and you're denying loans to Black people for whatever reason, which means that we got to come to an understanding. Either you're going to work with me to help Black people get access to the funding that they need to buy homes and buy commercial space to start businesses, or we're not going to run our money through your bank. We'll run it through banks that will work with us. So that's the type of pressure American put on people. Also, I mentioned earlier, we have to use every available opportunity to create programs where Black people can have an opportunity to participate. When you talk about Department of Housing, I asked them a question, how small does a project have to be before you fund it? They say, well, we don't like to fund smaller projects. We like the bigger projects. That's because they're lazy. They don't want to do the paperwork.
Exactly, exactly.
We're going to create a program, a separate pot of money that we've made available for people, many Black people, to be able to go and present a project saying, we're going to partner with a nonprofit and we're going to build 20 units of affordable housing on my property. They are not a subcontractor. They are a partner, which means that once the project is done, they have income coming in on a regular basis, which means that, for example, if you have a house and you've been upzoned, you can get the money to take that house down, build 20 units of housing, and you take the top floor as the penthouse, and everybody else is paying you rent. Now you got wealth coming in just like everybody else. That can happen, but it's not happening because you have people to talk about equity, what they want to do for Black and brown people, but when they talk about that, they only talk about the social issues. They don't talk about the economic issues, if you notice that.
Yeah.
They don't ever talk about it. They talk, well, we want to do a community center. We want to do a program. No. Put something in place where somebody can buy a commercial building.
Exactly.
Put something in place where they can tear down their house and build a 20-unit facility and live in it where everybody else is paying rent. That is how you bring about, but you have to have that leadership in place that knows this is not going on and say, this is what we're going to do. Stop talking about it and make it happen. And I've seen it happen all over the country. And that's what I'm bringing to the table. I really want to dig in and make sure that Black folks are having an opportunity to create wealth. And the only way to do that is to go in and make some substantive changes. And there's a way to do it without going against I-200.
Exactly. That's what we do. One of the biggest things that we want to get Black people to participate in everything like that when it comes to like voting and stuff, because after I got done with the interview with Bruce and stuff like that, and it just really frustrates me because I take it personally and stuff like with Black people and a lot of Asians and stuff like that, they're Latinos and all that, they don't vote. They sit back and they talk a lot of talk, and I mean, I've been in many arguments and stuff. And they'll argue for about a half an hour and a half in, come to find out they don't vote. They sure enough want to bump their gums. And it pisses me off. I'm like, whoa, wait a minute, hold up. You sitting up here talking about, oh, man, they ain't going to do nothing for me. Brother, you don't even vote. You need to sit down and shut up. If you ain't voting, you need to shut up. What can we do to sit back up here and get more Black folks, of course, more Latinos, more people of Asian, when I say Asian and stuff like that, not just Chinese and Japanese, I'm talking like Laotians, Vietnamese, Cambodian and stuff like that, especially living in South Seattle and stuff, Burien, South Seattle, West Seattle. to get to the polls and stuff like that to make these changes happen?
Well, it's pretty easy here in Seattle because you don't have to go to the polls.
Exactly.
All you have to do is get your ballot, and now they have a self-addressed envelope. You just gotta.
My biggest thing is you don't know your people. Yeah. I mean, I'm like, damn, bro, you got to go to the mailbox anyways, but we got to. Oh, man, they ain't about us. I mean, we had a, I'll give you an example. I was hanging out with some guys and stuff like that, and I was telling them about some of my interviews and stuff. And this is how it came down. He sat back up here, oh, man, until they sit back up here and give me what I want, I ain't going to give them a thing. And I came back, well, you forget, for hell with all them black folks back in the 60s and 50s who died and everything like that. You don't give a damn nothing about that. And he came back and he said, well, until they give me what I want, I ain't going to give them what. Well, that doesn't even make no sense. That's backwards, brah. You don't be in it, you know, but you want to talk all this smack. And there's a lot of folks and stuff like that. They'll bump their guns and talk all this stuff and be all into it. And come to find out, they don't even vote. And that's what pisses me off. And I sit back, like I said, I sit back up and I vote because of the people who did back in the 50s and 60s who died, who literally died intimidated, marched and all that kind of stuff for me to vote. And I hate to say this, Lionel, you're going to get up there and try to show your ass now. And it pisses me off. I'm like, no, I ain't having none of that kind of stuff. But what can we sit back up and do? Because it's no damn excuse for you not to be voting on something. I may not agree with what you voting for, but you do got to vote. And it's ridiculous. It's stupid dumb. You're going to do it to the mailbox any damn way. How damn hard is it to sit down here and take your five funky little minutes? You can be on TikTok, Facebook. Get off that. Take 5 minutes and get your butt out there and put your vote in. What can we do to sit back and encourage that? We got to cuss folks out? Pimp slap? What we got to do?
Well, Doc, you're about to preach a sermon here, man.
No, man. I can't believe it, man. I was with two Asian guys out there. We having lunch. And come to find out, I don't have any all this arguing and stuff about other stuff. And they're Republican. They didn't even vote for their own damn team. I'm wasting my damn time. They about to call the police on me because I'm about to tear up the joint, man. Oh, man, I ain't vote, man. You didn't even vote for your own squad, dog.
Yeah,
you ain't even backing up your own player, man. And my biggest thing is like, bet me, you ain't got no money on the table. Sit down, shut on up. You ain't got no dog in the fight. Sit down, shut up.
And imagine if we had to go through up here what people have to go through in Georgia.
Yeah.
All you got to do is get your mail, open it up, and they send you a pamphlet, look at it, read it, and then make an educated decision who you want to vote for.
Yeah.
There. They have passed laws where if you stand in, first they're going to reduce the amount of voting polling places you go and vote.
Mm-hmm. Dirty
move. You have to stand in long lines. So if you get hot in that summer heat in Georgia, they make it against the law for anyone to give you a drink of water.
Yeah, that's ridiculous.
So that's what I'm saying. Black people in Seattle, the fact that you're not a large portion of the population, 7%, which means that you are in a good position with all this wealth to take advantage of. Mm-hmm. You just have to know how to make things work. But we, like you're saying, we can't sit around, complain. We can't depend on the government to always give us the infusion of money that we need. We need to build a relationship with the private sector, because one thing that frustrates me is that we have opportunities for contracts for businesses to bid on opportunities with the state government, the county government, and the city government. And you got to go through this process, RFP process. It's just cumbersome.
Mm-hmm.
But I've got more deals just knowing a president of a company, a private company. And just because I got to know them and they took a liking to me, would give me a contract without going through on any of that stuff, because they can do that. They're not subject to these RFP rules. And I'm saying, with all these major corporations trying to find a niche, find you a niche, start a business or even purchase a business, but just find you a niche, put together a marketing strategy and try your best to get meetings. And it can happen. Get meetings with some private corporations so they know what you do. Establish a relationship. And then what happens, the next thing you know, they're going to call you and say, I have an opportunity for you.
Mm-hmm.
And they'll sit you down and talk you through it. And you're not doing an RFP. They're basically giving you an opportunity because they like you and they have a relationship. That is how we build wealth. When I was talking about my grandfather earlier, brother, he was a millionaire in the 50s.
Damn.
A contractor. He worked for one white general contractor and learned the business. Then he started on his own.
Mm-hmm.
This dude owned a cemetery, a nursing home, a funeral home, apartment complex, a cable company, built the first skating ring, all these things he did in the private sector. And then when he got to be an elected official, because he had so much money, he couldn't be bought. And he made a way for Black people in Bibb County before he got elected. The county was like 40% Black, 60% white, but only 5% of the Bibb County workforce was Black.
Mm.
He asked to be chair of the Human Resources Committee and struck a relationship with the director, who was a white guy named Leo Wright. And he told Leo, he said, going forward, any positions that will come open with Bibb County, I need to know some several months ahead of time so I can get the word out around the country to qualified Black people to come get these positions. And they struck that deal. And he was only an elected official for 6 years. But in that time, the Black population of workforce for Bibb County went from 5% to that 40%.
Man, that was excellent. Man, that really, really good numbers and stuff like that.
We got to stop talking, understand how things work, get inside and take advantage of the opportunities. The government can only do so many different things and set the groundwork. But the key is, if you can get those relationships with these affluent people in private businesses and they know you're about business, I'm telling you that they'll work with you. Man. I mean, they say it all the time.
Yeah.
You know, Black Lives Matter. I'm campaigning in Madison Valley yesterday, walking the streets. I'm seeing Black Lives Matter, and I'm seeing these $5 million homes.
Yeah, exactly.
Let's find out if they really matter. Let me put together my business and come to you as a private a corporate giant and say, hey, you said Black Lives Matter. A brother need a contract. A sister need a contract. This is what I do. Everything. But we have to make sure everything is on point now. Don't walk in any kind of way.
Exactly.
And that goes back to the teaching from my university. That's why when you see me, man, I'm always G'd up.
Yeah, you gotta have.
I'm always gonna give them this.
Yeah,
I'm always giving this.
Uh-huh.
I'm not gonna show up any kind of way because it makes a statement when you take time to look your best to go see people. That means I'm here about business.
Exactly.
So I don't ever show up any kind of way.
Oh, good. Hey, man. Been a really great interview. Anything else you want to add? This? How can we? Because I'll sit back, of course. That Ain't Black podcast to sit back up here and try to encourage other Black people, young Black, especially Black folks now and stuff like that. Because we, especially young Black folks, we got this technology and stuff in our hands.
Yeah.
Social media is powerful. Social media is more powerful than any gun.
Yeah.
And these young cuts out there, they got this kind of stuff, these fancy phones and stuff, and they can make stuff blow up on social media and look up technology and look up information and stuff like that. What can you do to sit back up and kind of encourage Black folks and stuff like that, especially the young ones that are coming on up and stuff like that, to get in the government so they can make these moves and make these decisions and stuff like that and not be intimidated and not be like, oh, man, I can't do that, man. I'm a brother. You know, the white folks are there. They got all this money and stuff like that. But you got a brain and stuff like that. Y'all got to network together, start shooting each other on up. You know, fussing, fighting, falling out, and get together and come together. Because the Asians don't did it. They got all kind of business in South Seattle and stuff. We got to be having all that kind of stuff. It's ridiculous because they got money there. The businesses are there, and the business is taking. We pouring money in other folks' business. We need to be pouring that money into our hands and stuff like that. Because that's ridiculous.
Right. So here's one thing that I want to say that I'm gonna ask you a question.
That
Black people, African American people, are at a permanent disadvantage when it comes to being connected to other resources around the globe. Because when we were brought here, we were separated, divided. We have no idea where we came from, our tribes. You can say ancestry.com all you want.
Exactly.
But there's nothing like knowing, being taught over the years of your ancestors and where they are.
Uh-huh.
We have Asian people who still have connections to people in Asia, where they're able to get the products and even financial resources that they need.
Mm-hmm.
Even have Mexican people, even they have connections in Mexico where they can get their products and things that they need to sell here.
Mm-hmm.
Even the African community, because a lot of the immigrants from across Africa, they have access to copper, to all types of things that they need that they can get from Africa.
Uh-huh.
African Americans, we don't have that connection. We don't have anyone that we know that's our relative in Africa, for where we are, wherever we came from, Africa and the Caribbean, whatever. We don't have those connections because we were stripped of that connection.
Uh-huh.
Which means that African Americans have to depend on themselves here as we exist.
Uh-huh.
Means that, I go back, we have to be nicer to one another, and we have to want to help one another, because that is the best way to build our network.
Uh-huh.
I'm just being honest. I've heard some people mm-hmm. tell me that they've approached some key leaders and political people for help.
Uh-huh.
And the first thing they say is, what is in it for me?
Yeah.
I've never done it and never will. I've helped many, many people, young Black businesses, to get going, give them whatever resource I've had to help them. Never asked them anything. I said, the way you pay me back is you be successful.
Uh-huh.
So my help is I'm not selling it to you. I'm giving it to you because I want you to be successful, number one. Mm-hmm. The second thing, you talk about technology.
Uh-huh.
I always tell my young people this: technology is a tool and not a toy.
Mm-hmm.
Use it as a tool to advance your education. Use it as a tool to get information and research to find out opportunities for business development, entrepreneurship. Use uh-huh. it as a tool to empower yourself, but we use it too much as a toy.
Yeah, exactly.
And we have to stop doing that. We have to, if you're going to use it, we need to use it more as a tool. The other thing, and I talked about earlier, we have to introduce our young people to opportunities as soon as possible. And the best way to encourage people to take a career pathway is we have to make funding available to pay them as they're learning.
Exactly, exactly.
We have to do that. We cannot say you can do this and you can do that and say you can grow up. Well, wait a minute, but I need some shoes now.
Exactly. Yeah, that's what I was getting at.
I got this little chick that I want to take to the movie.
Yeah.
And hold her hand, you know.
Exactly.
So we need to make sure that not only are we going to give you an opportunity to learn, to do something and encourage you, we're going to put a little change in your pocket.
Exactly, exactly.
So you don't have to worry about anything, but we don't do that.
Exactly.
We like to get them. We like to talk to them, but we don't put it in the pocket. So more investment of time, money, and energy into our youth.
Mm-hmm.
Finding our niche in the private sector with big corporations and other businesses. Let's create those partnerships, because that is where we build our financial stability without having to go through the headache of the government. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
Being nicer to one another. We have to love one another as Black people. We have to be concerned about one another.
Uh-huh.
Stop all this talking behind your back and criticizing.
Mm-hmm.
And if you say you're going to do it, you do it.
Exactly, exactly.
Bottom line. And then I'll end with this. When it comes to the political leadership, we have to take every opportunity. When you get there, you can't be politically correct. You can't be careful. You got to wreak havoc.
Yeah, yeah.
You got to wreak havoc. I remember Maynard Jackson, the reason why they named that airport after him was because when he got elected, he says, we got 25%. Goal when it comes to Black participation. And first somebody he talked to was the engineers. And he says, now, you know, we got this goal, so you need to make sure you reach this goal. So go find some folks. So they left and went a couple of weeks and came back to see Maynard. They told Maynard, we can't find any Black aerospace engineers in the country. So Maynard sent for the plans of the airport and laid them out and looked at them. And then he called another meeting with those engineers. He said, you know what? I get it that you say you can't find any aerospace engineers, but when I looked at the plans at this airport, it looks like an airport is just nothing but a bunch of driveways that are longer and wider. And I know plenty of brothers and sisters that can build driveways. They're doing it now. Mm-hmm. So he said, I tell you what, go and get them. Go and get them and bring them in here. Go find people to come and do this work. If you don't, weeds will grow up under this land and we won't have an airport.
Mm.
And it forced them to go and find people like Herman Russell, one of the most affluent, his company is one of the most affluent contractors in the country with $500 million plus capacity. These are the things that we have to do. I'm telling people, I'm running for this for the job. I'm not running this for a position, because I've been there, done that. I got mm-hmm. accolades. I got all types of stuff, and I don't talk about it. You mm-hmm. said earlier about why you don't know about this, because I just do the work.
Mm-hmm.
give me something else to do. As long as I'm helping people improve their lives, I don't need no glory, man. Mm-hmm. I just want to do the work. Uh-huh. But if you ask me a question, I'll tell you what I've done. But I'm more concerned about making sure you're successful, making sure you have what you need, doing what I can to help you. And if we all have the attitude with one another, you'd be surprised where this little 7% of Black folk in this city will go. We will be a powerful movement of people. We will have money and influence, and we'll have a lot to say about who our elected officials will be, because they will know not only to come to us to get our votes, they got to get our support. And there is a difference, because when you get elected, the elected official has to be supported as well.
You got to show and prove. Yeah, definitely. Exactly. All right, man. It's been a really great guest and everything like that, man. And
I've enjoyed it, man.
Definitely, man. Because I'm going to sit back up here and put this in last word and stuff. I'm going to undercut both you and Bruce, because I'm going to get it there about a week before the election. I'm going to say I'm the Black Trump Republican supporter from South Seattle, to create some controversy, going to drive up and down Rainier, passing out MAGA hats, and get people mad and sit back and say, listen up here, I'll be the worst Black mayor in Seattle, and I won't make Black folks so mad. Y'all gonna be pissed off at me. You say I got to vote because I got to get this brother the hell up out of here. He's down here talking all this smack. Oh my God, we definitely. I'm gonna sit back and try to get a funding to build a wall from here against Bellevue and stuff like that. Probably get about $1 billion too, man. It's gonna be a big old wall separating Seattle from Bellevue. And I probably, when I get in my campaign, I'll probably raise all that money in about a week too.
you're trying to start some trouble.
It's amazing, man, because you try to do some good stuff, man. You don't get no love. You do something stupid, you do something bad, especially on social media. You get thousands of likes, thousands of hits and stuff like that. Being dumb and being stupid. You'll get people viewing your page all the time. You try to do something educated, something smart, something good. Ain't nobody going to pay you time of day. They like, man, you be out there begging, pleading.
So,
you know, come on.
Yeah. So let me just say this, brother. Uh-huh. And I say this with all sincerity. I know Bruce very well. Bruce's a great guy, fun guy. And it's good that, you know, well, let me just say this. I lost my campaign February 2020. Mm-hmm. Nobody else was even thinking about it. I knew that Jenny Durkin, because I've been on politics enough to know that she may not run again. So I decided to put together my campaign. And before I did that, I asked around all over the city, was there anyone else that was looking to run? And no names came up. Uh-huh. So I put my hat in the ring and started raising money, meeting with people February 2020 before COVID. Mm-hmm. And even Bruce had said he wasn't going to run. Uh-huh. Fine. So I get into this race. I'm moving. I'm getting a lot of support from the Black community. I know a lot of people really don't know me from political circles, but they've gotten to know me. We're moving along. A lot of people coming on board with me. And then all of a sudden, my brother jumps in the race. I have his number. He has mine. Mm-hmm. He didn't call me anything. Didn't call me anything. So now we got both of us in the race. We could have worked something out. We could have talked. Uh-huh. We could have talked. But the deal is we're both in the race now. Uh-huh. But here's the thing I'm going to say. I love Bruce. I think he did what he could over 12 years as elected official. I think at one point he was on the school board as well. But one thing that we have to do as Black folks, mm-hmm, is we have to give others an opportunity to lead. Because what happens is what discourages a lot of people, and I'm not discouraged, uh-huh, but what discourages a lot of our young people that want to come behind and lead is that a lot of times we want to hold on to a position too long rather than pass it along so it can get stronger and stronger. Mm-hmm. And I'm bringing a different skill set. I'm bringing the economic development experience. I'm bringing a different flavor, and this is a good opportunity for it. And it would have been great to be the only candidate in the race that's Black African American to do this, to really bring us all together. But it's somewhat of a little bit of a split. Some people are uncomfortable because I know we go to the same church.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, I didn't know that. Oh man.
Yeah, and it's kind of uncomfortable. Uh-huh. And I was sort of hoping, you know, when I was I'm going to say hurt, but I just thought that maybe that Bruce would have called me and say, Lance, you know, people have asked me to do this and just do that and we can talk. But to not say anything to me, jump in the race, and now we got people feeling way. Because I've had people who were with me and they said, man, you know, I got to go with Bruce. You know, I grew up with him and this and that. I'm like, yeah, but they're 12 years. I mean, how often, I mean, we have to begin to cultivate and get other Black leaders besides, you know, we tend to have one at a time. Sam Smith, one. MacGyver, one. Bruce, one.
The one block. I call him the one block. We got one block person.
Barry Gossett, one. We have to get to the point where we can get more than one in different positions. You know, so I'm just throwing it out there because, you know, I just felt a little funny about that, you know, we didn't talk about it, but it's okay. We'll run. And I'm hoping that, that, you know, one of us can make it because it's time for someone to step in and whatever, you know, if I make it, I hope he'll help me along the way. We can do be successful. If he makes it, I'm gonna help him along the way. That's what I do. I don't have any animosity, especially to my brothers and sisters. And I'm beyond this, but I just wanted to bring that up. I don't have a problem. I love my brother. Great dude. But I just wish that we had had a conversation before he jumped in so that maybe we could capitalize on the fact that you got two good brothers that are running. And even James Dawson, you know, we got, you know, but we got, that's what I'm saying. We really have to coordinate and be strategic about doing things. And but I'm optimistic. Yeah. I'm optimistic that we're going to get there. I'm optimistic we're going to get there and realize our power and our ability and opportunities and we'll be a better community here in Seattle. So I appreciate the time, man. It's been a pleasure.
No problem, man. Because we all, at the end of the thing, we all playing on the same team, you know. We all playing on the same team. You know, like anything, we, you know, you can't, the quarterback can't be hating the running back, you know. You can't do it. You ain't going to win no game like that. They ain't going to win no game like that. That's the bottom line and stuff like that. And, man, really thanks for being a really great guest because I got this, this like Sunday, and oh, man, I was trying to do my research and stuff like that, trying to come up with some stuff. And, man, you got so much education. You got a big-ass catalog and stuff. I'm like, damn, I ain't no brother was like that. Because when I went in to get my shirts and stuff, I first heard about you because my boy said, yeah, this guy's running for the mayor's office too and stuff. And I said, oh, really? I looked him up. And, oh, good, good, good. I was like, dang. And then contacted your people and stuff like that. You hollered back at me real quick, real fast, and everything like that. I got you to here the next day, and it's really good, man. Really, you've really been a great guest. And either whether you or Bruce win, I don't care, man. I got, you know, go ahead and do your best, brother. Do your best and stuff like that. I'm going to be pumping up both of y'all and stuff like that. And all y'all Black folks out there, I'm going to tell you one more time. I'm going to throw in my candidacy about a week before these guys hit the stage. Be the first Black Republican in South Seattle passing out MAGA hats. Y'all gonna be mad at me because my first thing, if I get in office, anybody Black that don't vote, you're gonna get your butt the hell up out of here. I'll dog y'all out. I'll talk about y'all so bad. I'm gonna do the counter. I'm gonna talk about y'all so bad. We talk about, I'm gonna be the worst person in the damn world. You're gonna be begging. You're gonna be begging to put them, you're gonna be begging to give. You think Trump was bad? I'm gonna be double trouble. I won't sign my check. I won't say, yeah, I got the checks, running around there bragging, talking about all the money I got from the Republican Party, man. But hey, man, thanks again for being a person on my show, an interviewer. You've been really great, Mr. Lance Randall, for the 2021 Seattle mayoral candidate. Hope you and Bruce do good and stuff like that. May the best man win. And hey, go ahead and thanks for being on my podcast and everything one more time. And you want to close it up? Anything else you want to add in there? Last minute, last second, last minute in your window? No,
I just thank you for the opportunity, man. And I've enjoyed it. And I want you to be blessed in everything that you do.
Okay, man. Thanks a lot, man. Thanks a lot, man. Thanks to you so much and everything. And go ahead, please listen to my podcast and everything. Pump me up and get me my name out there and everything. And I really appreciate so much everyone who does listen, even though you're only a handful of y'all. We care about this stuff. But thanks a lot, man. Thanks a lot one more time. And have a good campaign trail. So.
All right. Thank you, man.
All right.